Dear friend, I'm so sorry that I could not join you for this conference. I was really looking forward, but I could not make it for family reasons. I really wanted to come to learn more from the Irish experiences, especially women experiences. I was first trained by Monica McWilliams, who told me a lot about your experiences in achieving peace in your country, and I hope that we could make it one day in Syria. Violence is not part of the Syrian culture and has never been a part of the culture, Syrian culture. Syrians are known for diplomatic manners, for their civilization. They were the first to bring the peace to the whole world. But it was only between husband and wife. It was okay by the cultural norms to commit violence. So it was okay for a man to kill a woman for honor crime. It was okay for a man to beat his wife. And I believe that unless we fix gender inequality in these societies, there is no way we can achieve a sustainable peace in Syria. And of course you see that the people who are coming to fight with ISIS in Syria are bringing the same values, that women are something we own, something we sell in the market. And this is what they are doing to the Syrian women now. So unless we change this mentality, not only in Syria, but in all countries where they believe in it, there is no way to achieve a sustainable peace in the world. In Syria, we need to push the political process happening in Geneva to ensure a political transition. And when I say transition, it's a transition between violence to peace, from war to peace, from war to political process. And it only should happen through a political transition where we ensure that there is a democratic change in Syria, but it's democratic change which has three wings: democratic change, human and women rights, and sustainable development. And for all of this, it's only women who are capable of achieving them. Sustainable development is very vital for achieving peace, and it's only women who could make sustainable development. They can do it through their involvement in education. They are the first educator for their babies. They educate the values of peace or the values of war, the values of forgiveness or the values of revenge. So sustainable human development would only achieve by women involvement, and this is why we should really focus in Syria not only in peace building but also in achieving sustainable development. We need to change the mentality toward a more developmental perspective and to create hope among people so that we could counterpart the mentality of ISIS, which is spreading in the region. The second reason, women are very active at the local level, and they are the linkages between villages. They are the people who could invite the whole family, the whole region, the whole village to dinner, to talk, to change ideas about their future of Syria. So building peace at the local level, which was backed up by achieving development at the local level, is the only way toward peace. Of course, this is what come after an international agreement, because we know now the war in Syria is a proxy war, and it's only through an agreement of the American and the Russian and the regional key players at the peace, the national peace, could occur. But of course, then the peace at the local level, at the grassroots level, would never achieve without the involvement of women. The third point is that women are the majority in Syria now. We lost so many women, men. They were kidnapped, killed, immigrated, traveled, prisons. So we are a country, at the end of the war, will be a country of women. The women are alone by their children. They are the breadwinner. They have to face reality which has never seen before. They have to be involved in work because they are responsible of the family. So it's a new reality. While war is horrible, but it's opened a small window for Syrian women, and we need to keep this window after the war. We need to continue empowering women after the war so that they could play their prospective role for the future of Syria. We need to Also, we need also to empower women politically, because I think whatever women are doing at the civil society level, they will never be able to keep it unless they are in politics. Politics is power. Unless you have the power, you cannot protect the gain you achieve at the different social and civic level. So my goal is to encourage women to be engaged in power, to be leaders, to be political in the political parties, to be a president for political parties, vice presidents. And we really want to do it in a systematic way. How? By putting this in the Agreement of Geneva. Unless we put it in the Agreement of Geneva that we need a woman at the level of vice president and that the woman can be a president for Syria, prime minister, this is, should be documented, because once we go to Syria to implement the international agreement, the Geneva Agreement for Peace, the men will try to withdraw these rights of women. So it should be written in paper and it should be approved by the international community, as it was approved by the Security Council Resolution 2254, that women should be in all decision makers' position. I think women also need to be organized, and this organization should take different level. First level, and we are working on it, is organization at the national level. To that perspective, I worked very high in the Riyadh meeting for the opposition to establish the Syrian Commission for, it was the Women Consultative Committee for the High Negotiation Committee. And I'm not part of it now, but I know that the people who are running it are very effective. They are trying to bring women to politics, and they are trying to push for the negotiation agenda at the international level. Also, the Women Advisory Board for Mr. De Mistura, the special UN envoy for Syria, I am part of it. And this is very special because it includes 12 women from different political background. And it's not only inclusive and diverse, but also to bring the women from the women movement. And this is very important because it's not enough to have a woman activist. Not all the women are carrying the women agenda. So most of the people who are in the Women Advisory Board are coming from the women movement. We were working years. I have been working now for 20 years. The president of the chair of the Women Advisory Board has been working for 40 years on women issues, and they are known internationally for their contribution to women movement in Syria and in the world. So this is very important to bring the women agenda on the table. And also recently we conducted a conference in Beirut with the support of the UN Women, where we brought different women from inside Syria, and that was the first time where women from really different political background come together. They share their pain, they cry together, and they share their vision for future of Syria. And they agreed and promised each other that they will work together to have a better place for their children in the future of Syria. I think this was very unique, where we are two different women talking about their experience and committing themselves to work together despite all of their political differences for the future of Syria. I think that was a very unique experience for me. Now, organizing women at the national level, I always believe that men and women who are inside the country are the most important key player for the future of Syria, as they are there. It will be their responsibility to rebuild the country. To that perspective, we work, I personally, with my organization, Syrian Women Forum for Peace, work to organize women inside the community to have their own organization. Very, very recently, we have launched, women from my network have launched two new organizations. And we are working also on the constitution. We have launched a national coalition for institution. Very recently, 2 days ago, they have a workshop on how to gender mainstream constitution. Working inside Syria is very challengeable, but it's possible if we have the right ways and the right people who should be technically strong and they should know what they are talking about so that they can continue working inside the country. Syria is full of very special women, and we should always continue supporting them. I hope that this has given you an idea about what you are doing. Of course, we have a long way to go. Geneva is only a start. And I hope that we will have a chance to bring other women to Ireland to meet with you, to learn from you, and to get your support for peace in Syria. Thank you very much.
Very grateful to Mona for taking the time to make that message for us. So all messages of support to Mona would be very welcome. We'll pass them on. So I'm just very happy to welcome back Mary Robinson, who's going to chair the rest of the session with Monica McWilliams and Ray Murphy. So.
And could I say I was really sorry that we decided it was a good idea to have a board meeting of the Mary Robinson Centre during this symposium, because it's hard to get board members together, and a number of them wanted to come along, particularly for this afternoon session. So that meant I missed the second session of the morning and the performance over lunch and the company of all of you during that time. But I am very pleased to have been able to hear the video presentation by Mona Ghanem. You know, I am asked, and I'm sure Monica and Ray might be the same, to give quite a few video presentations. It actually saves the emissions of traveling to a place. So I offer quite a lot, if I can't go to somewhere, to do a video. That was one of the best video presentations I have seen, because she spoke from the heart, she spoke about her work, and she seemed really to want to communicate with us. And so please, you know, convey. You know that we're, what's the word, trending, because of your lovely tweets. So, you know, tweet a bit about her, because I think it'd be good for her morale as well. And I think that, and Monica, you're going to be my first speaker, and I know that you know her, and I'd be happy if you can amplify what I've said. I've known Monica for how long?
40 years.
40 years at least, yes. And of course, as you can see from her bio, she has played very distinguished roles in Northern Ireland. She's been the Chief Commissioner of the Northern Ireland Human Rights Commission. She's been awarded for various activities that she's done. She's currently the Professor of Women's Studies and Research Fellow at the Transitional Justice Institute at Ulster University. I think she's a very well-known woman from Northern Ireland who is known internationally. And so, Monica, it's my pleasure to give you the floor.
Good afternoon, everyone. Delighted to be here in Ballina. When I left Belfast yesterday afternoon, and I was working actually with a woman from Afghanistan, and I'll mention that later, people around the table asked me where I was going. And remember, it's the 1st of July, and I said, because it's the 12th fortnight, if you know Northern Ireland, everything closes, and the Belfast Telegraph says they would the last person leaving Belfast switch out the lights. And I said, I'm going to Ballina, County Mayo. They said, oh, wonderful, for the 12th fortnight holiday. I said, no, for the Mary Robinson Symposium. And they said, are people still working down there in the 12th fortnight? So slightly different, but I am, Mary, absolutely delighted. And somebody said this morning, when Mary calls, you go, yes, I will be there, and jump high. But I'm also here because Niamh, who I have the most amazing admiration for, Niamh, in terms of your work over the years. And when Niamh asked me to come, and all the greetings go to both of you from all the women in Northern Ireland who were envious, who were heading off on their holidays, actually. Otherwise, they would have been here. This story is my story. It's the story of how did we get involved in the peace-building exercise in Northern Ireland. Where did we come from? How did we get to the table? What have we been doing since? And then I'll talk at the end a little bit about my good friend Mona, It was a very sad, actually, moment for me watching Mona. I can hear the grief in her voice. Not only has she lost a member of her family, and that's the reason why she's not here, but I would imagine that grief is coming from deep down. When my sister and I went to Istanbul 5 years ago to do the work with the women, 5 years ago, and we thought we were just starting a process that would end pretty quickly. Mona was the first woman of all that group of women that we met. And we were talking about her today, and we were saying how much we were looking forward to seeing her, because she is the strongest, most dynamic, outspoken woman. And what you saw there was a very grief-ridden woman. And I just can't get that away from me. And that's what war and violence does. It kind of does take your voice down a few pegs. And you can see it in her eyes. But here, we don't want to go back to this scene. My question is, how far have we come? That's Dayton talks, the Balkan. And some of those are war criminals at the front. So that was certainly not how to build a peaceful, inclusive society. And every time I go back to Bosnia now, the women tell me how much they're suffering as a consequence of how these men drafted up their future, or didn't. And it's very sad, and it was 1995. There weren't many women at the peace negotiations around the world. My good friend Christine Bale and Catherine O'Rourke documented how often women are involved. Only 4% of women are signatories, and there's only ever about 12% in total at the table, or even as observers and witnesses. Our story was 1998, so it was before United Nations resolutions, Security Council Resolution 1325, Women, Peace and Security, which made a demand that women should be included. So we came 2 years before that, and so that picture isn't unusual. I think I've shrunk since then. I look pretty small there, but I think I've, as the years have gone on, maybe got smaller. But if we had not formed the Women's Coalition, that would have been an all-male picture, probably similar to the one I just showed you earlier. So the question is, how much progress are we making around the world? We celebrated, this day was Belfast International Women's Day. We were celebrating 100 years of International Women's Day from 1911 to 2011, from here to equality. It was a great day, and we have great International Women's Day still on the 8th of March, where we still march for bread and for roses. And we sing those songs as we go along. But the issue really is the issue of power. How do you get that power? Do you share out in that power? How do you share in it? And it's at different levels. It's at the global, national, local, and household. And we've got to match those levels up. And I'll talk a little bit about that in terms of what's going on in your household. And for many women, that's their first experience of not having an equal share in either the distribution of resources, or even worse, where there's coercive power and control going on over their lives. But how do we connect that to the local, the national, and the global? The spaces that we're in, and we, women in Northern Ireland, found ourselves closed off. We weren't invited, and we had to go out and claim the space. And the forms of power, they're very visible in terms of pictures of parliaments and democracy, or they can be very hidden, and indeed become very invisible. So how do we make the most invisible forms of power more visible? How do we get them into constitutions, as Mona just said, in terms of the drafting of any future Syrian constitution? So the common barriers that we face in building peaceful and inclusive societies, which is what Goal 16 is about, is really tackling these common, deep-seated gender norms of low self-esteem, the lack of independent finance, and that triple burden of reproductive, productive, and community work. And no matter where I go, that's the commonality in nearly all conflicts. And you've all heard this, and we heard it. What about women's rights? Oh, they'll come later. Either that they're too trivial now to prioritise, that abuse of women is a cultural issue, you should stay away from it, it's not a political problem. The abuse of women is so pervasive that to make it a human rights issue, it would overwhelm all other issues. Or over and over again, and even on the last night of Good Friday, we heard it, women's rights can wait until we sort out all the other priorities. That was actually articulated to me sadly by another woman in another party on that night. More recently, this past six months, was given the job of disbanding paramilitaries in Northern Ireland. That sounds like an interesting job, doesn't it? The First Minister and Deputy First Minister literally rang me on Christmas Eve and asked if I would join a three-member panel. And like most women, when you get that kind of phone call, you're very daunted. I asked who the others were, two men, and I thought for a moment, and I thought, I'm probably going to be the first woman that's been asked to join such a panel since we've implemented the agreement in 1998. Because all the panels since that day to this have all involved men. The International Monitoring Commission, the Independent Reporting Commission, the Decommissioning Commission. You mention any commission or committee to oversee the peace process, and it was men, and mostly international men. And so I thought, I do what most women do, and I immediately said back on the phone call, you know, I know a better woman who could do this job than me. And I did. And I gave her name, and they said, no, that's not how it works. We've put your name down through the rank and files, and it's come back that you're all right. So you're going to do it whether you like it or not. So I said, is that the choice? Ah, that's grand, sure, I'll take it then, and I'll do it. And so from Christmas Eve till literally this week, or a few weeks ago, I've been working on that. And the reason why I'm telling you that is because a peace process is a process, it's not an event. All that the agreement was us signing words. And it's taken us almost 20 years, stage by stage, to implement that, to build an inclusive society, to build a peaceful society. But what I learned was a great deal of attention was put on to disarmament and into demobilisation of both the military and the paramilitaries. And that's the same in nearly everywhere that we go. I just read this excellent report carried out by Niamh, which is part of the centre here in NUI Galway. And it's on women's leadership and participation in the peace, security and cooperation framework for the Democratic Republic of the Congo and the Great Lakes. And the issues are exactly the same, about the issues of disarmament, the issues of demobilisation, and what actually got priority. And I'll talk about this later as an example of good practice. I'm absolutely so impressed. I only got it today, but I have managed to read it today. And much of what I'm saying is inside the cover of this report. But
let's give a round of applause.
Yeah. And these are the kind of guys I was dealing with. They weren't exactly dressed like that. They did come in civvies. But I took the view that the emphasis on guns and weapons is important, but not all arms are imported. And at the peace table, peace negotiations, I used to say, not all arms are imported. Because one of the issues that women face is that the arms that we're talking about can be the violence of the tongue, as well as the violence of a gun, or the violence of a rope or a knife, but often they'll tell you it was what was said that they remember afterwards. And so what's written on that arm is what I still hear. I'm still doing work on domestic violence. I'm repeating a study I did 25 years ago called Bringing It Out in the Open. And I'm back now doing exactly the same study, asking exactly the same questions to see how much has changed 25 years later, even though we've got a political settlement. So violence can be hidden, it can be visible and invisible. And it's often the violence against women when we took to reclaim the streets, which is what this picture shows you from Belfast, was that to make something that was so ordinary and being treated as so extraordinary, that we wanted to have it being made visible and talked about in a very different way. They used to talk about ordinary decent crime and ordinary decent murders. When I sat down to count the murders of the women who had been killed in domestic violence, I had to get out a file in all the police stations where the ordinary decent murders were listed. So think about that, a murder being ordinary and decent, mm-hmm. as a contrast to another file in the police stations that listed all the murders as a result of the political troubles. And they were kept in different files. So in this strategy, I wanted to ask, are we prepared for peace or ready for war again? Why do you need this emphasis on paramilitarism? And had I not been on that panel, and I won't have time to talk much about it, I don't think there would have been in the final report words around gender, words around masculinity, words around why do these men continue to hold this kind of coercive power that they have received so much benefit from, and indeed why are women intimidated to the extent that they are in some communities, both out on the streets and towns, but also in their own homes. So I did put recommendations in on all of that, and also about the role of women in community development. But to build a peaceful and inclusive society, which is what Goal 16 is talking about, I have always thought about this in three ways. First, you need to have a very inclusive process, that at each and every stage you should ask, are women at the table? And if not, why not? And how do we involve those women and civic society? Then if you get to the table, that's not just enough. You need to have substance. What are the interests that women put on the table? And you heard Mona speak about the fact that when, and I don't believe I could ever train a woman like Mona, what we did was we did some capacity building workshops, which we ourselves benefited from in Northern Ireland, where women from other countries came to train us about negotiations and constitutions and drafting. And what really what we told them to focus on was their interests, because there will be plenty of other people at the table talking about their interests, and that you do need women to focus on what are their specific interests. And I'll come back to that issue. What is the substance? So first, working hard to get the process, to make it inclusive, but also then when you get there, how inclusive will the agenda be? How comprehensive will the agreement be? And the third and the hardest for me, and still is how do we get what was promised delivered? How do you get what was meant to be a guarantee, or what was meant to be a proposal and a clause in your agreement finally implemented? And I have to say, Brexit last week will set us back somewhat on that score. It has to include...
I hate to interrupt you, Monica, but can you just say a little bit about how you feel about Brexit?
Yep, actually? I will.
Yeah.
Brexit's a disaster for Northern Ireland. When we drafted the Good Friday Agreement, Europe was very much at the heart of it, Mary, as was the European Convention on Human Rights. Not only have the UK has made this decision to exit from EU, but Cameron had already made a decision to exit from the European Convention, and to tear up the Human Rights Act, and to bring in a British Bill of Rights, which he and the Conservative government would draft. Well, you can begin to imagine what that Bill of Rights might look like, especially if they were dissatisfied with the rights of the European Convention. So 50 years ago, it was Conservatives who introduced the European Convention of Human Rights into Europe following the war, and 50 years later, it's Conservatives who are taking us away from that. Why is it a disaster for Northern Ireland? Well, constitutionally, it's a disaster. We have the most disunited kingdom that we will ever have as a result of Brexit. Scotland will go in one direction. Northern Ireland will be forced into a referendum that maybe is ahead of its time. And constitutionally, this whole issue where we didn't have the North and the South was almost no longer in our heads in terms of borders, in terms of how we thought about each other. And all of that is a concern that it may be reinstated. The only light at the end of the tunnel I can see is when I was the Chief Commissioner for Human Rights, and Mary, you will know this because you were involved with this process, was in the Good Friday Agreement, it fell to the Commission to mandate. Mandated the Commission to draft a Bill of Rights for Northern Ireland. It was the hardest task I ever did, because you had to reach out to all the sectors, the women's sector, disability sector, victims, business trade union, all the interests that you can imagine. And we did it. The previous commission and my own commission finally produced the advice and handed it over on the 40th anniversary of the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. And you remember you came to Belfast at that time and asked, where is this Bill of Rights? And it was delivered. And it has sat on a shelf in number 10 ever since. And I can only see a bit of light in that as a result of Brexit, people have woke up in total shock in Northern Ireland and have asked, where is our Bill of Rights? And so there may be a bit of lining in that there will be a rejuvenation of that discussion around human rights. Because how will it be possible in this jurisdiction, which is so near to us, that you have these human rights and in Northern Ireland we won't? And I agree with whoever it was, I think it was a member of the Social Democrat Party this morning asked the question about legislators being much more informed about how do you draw down international standards and how do you actually implement human rights. The same debate in Northern Ireland, and it's much needed. But at least now we are going to be able to say that the Republic of Ireland is way in advance. And many years ago, perhaps Northern Ireland would have said something different in relation to some of these rights. Anyway, a ceasefire was declared in 94. Peace talks were declared shortly after the ceasefires. And we said, if these old systems don't work, try something different, be inventive, ask why not. And when we discovered that they only had the old parties down as listed for election, plus the two new parties that were affiliated to the loyalist paramilitaries, we thought, that's not going to be a good sign. It will end up being all men. And so we wrote to all the parties. The only party that had the decency to respond was the Communist Party, but they were probably not going to get elected as one of the 10 parties. And so we decided we'll have a go at this ourselves, just to put it up to the other parties that they need to put more women at the table. It was quite a shock, I have to tell you. We had to be the most reluctant politicians of all time, accidental activists, literally, that we fell in and got elected and became one of those 10 parties. But we didn't come from nowhere. This is a picture of the civil rights movement. I was on this march, as was my sister. It was the week after Bloody Sunday. You can see the black flags hanging from the windows. The women got fed up by not being recognized as the leaders of the civil rights movement. And they demanded that day to take the front line on that march. There was over 100,000 on the march. But no one knows their names. And standing behind them, those men went on to become leading politicians. So getting written out of history is something that can happen very quickly. There are all kinds of activists, peace activism, women's rights activism, party political, human rights, conflicted activism. I remember us tearing each other apart in the early 70s over the issue of strip searching and issues like that. And it was very hard to build an inclusive coalition where we could focus on what we wanted if we went to this table. Trade unions were involved. Inis McCormick, now deceased, a good friend of Mary's, led much of this discussion in terms of women in the trade union movement. And I put this up because too often women are expected to be build inclusive societies, but more as the voice of victims, or more as the voice of essential peacemakers. But you just saw a picture earlier where I showed women as combatants. And all of those voices need to be heard. Women are very resilient, they're agents of change, and we jumped from the margins to the mainstream. But we didn't do it without having built on these pre-existing networks. And we came from mostly civic activism and came together to make this decision. We wanted to change the face of politics, and indeed, as I said, and someone mentioned it this morning, Beijing had happened at that time, and we talked about bringing Beijing back home. All we did was put three principles: inclusion, human rights, and equality. And on those, we built all our policies. We did not take a strong stand on the constitutional issue. We said that in the peace talks, we would find a way of how to resolve that on consensus issues. But those were the three that we tested our own party by, we tested our society by, and we often were tested ourselves by in terms of it. And I can, if you want for me to explain how you put that into practice, I can do so afterwards. Because the media can take you apart in very conflicted societies where you might think you have these grand principles and then some crisis breaks out or a riot happens or a parade goes down your street and you're then asked, how do you see that from a human rights perspective? So we went out. 6 weeks later, we got elected. I didn't realize at the time that that's Japanese. The Japanese and all the world's media were following us. But that newspaper is upside down because I don't speak Japanese. And I didn't realize that that's what I was doing. But these are some of the comments from the leaders at that time. Women should leave politics and leadership alone. And those men have changed their views now. That was Peter Robinson. But this was Seamus Mallon, who in many ways was one of the leaders of the agreement. And he said, the Women's Coalition must be a cult and they'll grow into each other and finally disappear. Now, that was the views that were held towards us at the start. I have to say those views changed, but it took some time for us to build the credibility. So when it was over, what do you build? And time to build, I showed this week to our summer school in Belfast, where there's over 24 women from all different parts of the world in conflict. And some of the women actually started to cry when they saw this. because that's only a dream for them still. And it struck me, I mean, I remember this being, and we were euphoric, absolutely euphoric when we thought, it's over. Mm. But what are we going to build and how are we going to build it? So there's different dimensions now to peace building, and they're not that different from different parts of the world. Unfortunately, often you end up with the geopolitics. For Syria, it's the involvement of China and Russia, and Iran, or Europe, or the United States, and all the massive partners at the table. For us, we had many of these at the table, but we also had to focus on the issues. Economic development and social progress, often it's in our agreement, but got much lower priority. The governance arrangements, high priority. Policing and justice, high priority. The reconciliation and issues to do with victims and the legacy of the past, low priority. So it is very important not just to have a comprehensive agreement, but to make sure that you move on that agreement in an inclusive fashion. Otherwise, the spirit comes out. If we had not been at the table, what would not have been there? And this is a list. I unfortunately do not have time to go into all of it. But I noticed in your report, Niamh, that there was also a civic forum in the Congo, which is incredible because it was an idea that we had in 98 to bring in new blood, to involve civic society, to sit alongside the legislative assembly. It got into the agreement. It was proudly accepted as a new way of doing participatory democracy. And as soon as the parties got into the assembly, they abandoned it. And it's never been established since. So you do need champions and you need political will. There was a right to of women to full and equal participation in political life. We succeeded in getting that in. I'll show you in a moment what happened to that one. And all of the rest, the Bill of Rights is still not implemented. I'm very glad to say we managed to get some words in on victims. Yes, I negotiated for the prisoner releases. I did see the reason why prisoners should be released, but when I went out to knock on doors, I said we need to have words in here about victims. Otherwise, people will throw this agreement back in our faces and call it a terrorist charter. So again, inclusive, inclusive, inclusive. Had women not been at that table, there would not have been a section in that agreement on the rights of victims. Nor on integrated education, nor on mixed housing, nor on what you spoke about this morning, the needs of children, the needs of young people. All of those sentences in the agreement and the importance of civic society and community development was all put there by the Women's Coalition. The parties were way off negotiating on new governance arrangements, which we were also supportive of, and as I said, policing reform, security reform, disarmament, decommissioning, getting the prisoners out in 2 years, whilst we were sitting focusing on many of these issues. We lost a few issues. We lost electoral reform, and I regret that we did. Everybody gives up something. Sorry that we had to give that one up, because we wanted affirmative action, and none of the parties at that time were ready to accept that. This is a picture of the final night of Good Friday. I'm glad we didn't sign it on Pancake Tuesday. It might have had a different ring to it. It's kind of, and actually today we still can't agree on what it's called. It's called the Belfast Good Friday, stroke Good Friday Agreement. That was our moment in the sun and the hard work started then. And I call this the Where's Wally picture. So for all of the rights of women's right to full and political participation, you can pick the women out in that picture. I always wore a white jacket or, like Mary, a red coat because it looked like Wall Street when you walk into an arena like this. And that's probably why I stick out a little in this photograph. But that's a democratic deficit. Mm-hmm. And was that our transformed society? Was that what we believed was to be the future? So the elephant is still on the table. There was a refusal to accept affirmative action outside of the governance arrangements, outside of the recruitment of Catholic officers to the police. For gender, it was a no-no. Here are the five reasons that my colleague argues women have to be in Goal 16. For representation, for deliberation, for inclusion, there are things that happen to us in terms of expertise that we have that on gender-specific harms, but also our skills and capacity. And finally, as role models. And as you know, and I know, there is no better role model in this world than Mary Robinson. And everywhere you go, people talk about Mary Robinson. But Mary Robinson must be a very tired woman because she needs a whole lot of other role model women. being the first UN special envoy, being asked this. I'm sure Mary answered those phone calls many a day saying, and could you find another woman, please?
Yes.
So the implementation is the hardest. Ask who's doing what, is there a budget? You talked this morning about budgets, such an important discussion. Where will the resources come from? What are they attached to? What are the benchmarks? Is there a timetable? And that's why I want to go back to that report of Neve's. If you want to understand how to do that, read that report. In the appendix, in the section, Neve has outlined how to do it, and we did the same. Here's the recommendation. This is the action. This is the benchmark. This is the timetable. And here's the priority that we believe in monitoring that it has now received. That's what I call good practice. And we did not do it in the Good Friday Agreement, and we should have. Had I to go back, but you always think if you had to go back, what would you do differently? Retrospect's a great person to have at the table. But if I had to go back, that's what I would do. We had put too many aspirations and not enough guarantees and benchmarks and timetables. Mm. Oh, for sure, we were going to release prisoners. We knew how many and we knew what day. Mm. Oh, for sure, we were going to set up an international commission, and for sure we set it a timetable. But for all of these others, no, that will become with political goodwill. And I have to say that those days have, Goal 16 has to move on and be much more certain about what this looks like. So, yes, criminal justice is important, but so too is social justice. And this is what you will find women all over the world talking about. Trokra, whose board I'm on, and one of my heroes is sitting in, Sean Farrell right there, whose work I have watched around Africa, who has done the most amazing work. And Mary, you're joining Trokra next week, I believe, and with Concern.
Concern and Goal.
And Goal, and going to Ethiopia. And this was a public awareness issue on violence against women in Uganda and in DRC. I was absolutely amazed at the posters the Muslim community were producing on domestic violence in Kampala, but also what the Catholic bishops were producing. And Sean, you remember this story because you gave me the pencil sketch. And on the left, you see the symbolism of what men should not be doing. They shouldn't be walking and listening to radios and have the poor woman with the bicycle loaded up going to market with all the burden and the little children. And she's got all that responsibility whilst he's dancing along listening to his radio. Or he shouldn't be sitting shouting back at those women in temper and anger. On the right-hand side is a very different picture of what equality should look like side by side. They had a row over that bicycle because when they first threw that bicycle, the man, as is tradition in the places we visited, was walking behind the woman. The woman was in front as she goes to the market. She is the one doing the trading. But there was such an outcry by the local bishops, as well as I think the local men, that they had to put the wee man beside her on the bicycle. But at least it looked like side by side. And of course, the picture of harmony at the front. But still, I was thinking to myself, there's a whole lot of more awareness being raised there than there is often being raised here on some of these issues. So strategies need to be focused, as I said. When we mobilise, we have to bring a gender analysis to the discussion. We do need to include action. Democracy has to include the intimate, the issues I've just talked about, as well as the more official issues. I've just mentioned this report, and I've been there to Eastern Congo, again with Trokra, and witnessed. These are women. You can see the absolute poverty they're living in. This is a wee shed with no roof on it. And those women are standing up discussing how to get elected to their local councils and the bravery of them. There were some men sitting amongst these women, and I have to say the respect that the men showed towards the women I had not experienced when I first stood up and said I wanted to be counted. Colombia has succeeded in very late stage of including the women in Havana in a parallel discussion. I was with this woman in the black and white skirt all week in Belfast. She is the leading woman from the Philippines who negotiated with the Islamic Moro group, Miriam Corona Ferrar, an unbelievable woman. And she said when they started out, they only had a few women. By the time they'd finished, they had snowballed their effort to include many women. And as a result, the Islamic Moral Group started including women as well. But they were smart enough to have a validation committee as well as their peace talks. Very smart lesson. And these are the women from Syria that I am now working with in Gaziantep. And those women are all widows. And they have a major issue in that they cannot hand on their inheritance to the next generation because there's no men in their families. These are the issues that Mona is now talking about. If they draft a new constitution, that has to change, because if it becomes a country of women, then how do you pass on the right to have passport and the right to be recognized? Those women were so frightened. As you can see, most of them have their back. They can't even let their photographs be taken, even though they are wearing clothes where you can hardly see their face. It's dangerous. So finally, we have let Syria down. There's enormous violations. I think that picture says it all. The woman screaming from underneath with the blood running from her, and the UN photographer shouting, "Say cheese." So it's not a pick and mix. That's a picture of me as the Human Rights Commissioner. I love that picture, where you're sent up, and I'm telling two of the commissioners who didn't want some of the rights in the Bill of Rights, it's not a pick and mix. And so the issue for Syria, as is for all of us, is not to let their future constitution become a pick and mix, as for Egypt or for any of the other Middle Eastern countries. But their civil society is getting closed down. At the very time, and you've probably found this, Mary, going around, that more and more civic society has been threatened. Eastern Europe, Africa, Northern Ireland also is facing very hard times. This is the woman I've spent this week with, other women from the High Peace Council. She's the most senior woman in Afghanistan. Can you believe they're coming to Belfast to learn from our process? I find it very heartening. But she said something, and I think she'll now have gone back with it. She said, well, I'm also responsible for drafting this peace agreement and getting involved with the Taliban. And she said, I think we'll set down having Islamic principles. I said, no, universal principles. And she has rethought that. And I thought, I'm so glad she has spent time with us, because Afghanistan cannot, no more than we could have, built after 1916 and 1938 here on one only faith community. And so those perhaps are the lessons. The final picture shows that we've made some precarious progress in the little part of the world I come from. These women were in the front, all leaders of their parties, deputy leaders at that time. One was the leader of the SDLP, the other the leader of Progressive Unionist Party. The only woman that's still standing is the one you would have least expected. The inheritance of Reverend Ian Paisley is Arlene Foster. And I just picked this picture up from the Speaker of the Assembly, retired Speaker now, asked the art students to paint the new Stormont. And in the front of it, it says something that I never thought I'd see when I first went to Stormont, and it talks about diversity and a Stormont, a sense of place, respect, reflection, and a new history. And one of the students has painted a picture: woman elected as a first minister, a new history begins now. And so in many ways, the question for me was, where did we start out from? Where are we now? And there cannot be no peace without women. So let's all imagine that new political order. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Monica, for that wonderful presentation, drawing on your own rich experience in Northern Ireland, but also showing how you link out to so many women's groups and share that experience and help to encourage through that sharing. I have to say, on your last point, for what it's worth, it is possible that within the United Kingdom you might have four women.
That's right.
you know, if Theresa May...
That's right.
And then in Northern Ireland, and the two in Scotland.
And Plaid Cymru.
And Plaid Cymru, yes.
And the Green Party.
Yeah.
All women leaders.
So, could be a sweep. I'm not sure it's going to...
Possible.
I'm not sure it's going to help resolve Brexit.
No, it probably won't.
I now have great pleasure in inviting our last presenter this afternoon, Ray Murphy, who's the Acting Director of the Irish Centre for Human Rights that Mary Robinson Centre has a close link with, as well as the with the Women's Centre. And I also have a long history of association from when it was established by Kevin Boyle, so I'm really glad that we have that link. And I invite you, I'd like to invite you, Ray, if you would, to begin just by some quick response to what Monica was saying. I thought it was good this morning when there was a response by the speakers to the earlier presentation. So just a quick reflection on what Monica was saying, and then what are you planning to say?
Okay, thanks, Mary. The first thing I'd ask is, after 15 minutes, just give me a gentle reminder.
Because
one of my promises to Niamh was that I would just spend 20 minutes. So, and I promise, as the last speaker, I'm aware that you've had a long period this weekend. But in response, actually, one of the things that I was concerned about coming here is that I hadn't any communication with the other speakers, and how would my talk reflect the themes? And because I'm looking at the macro UN missions situation and some relevant issues. And especially Muna's talk in regards to Syria and some of the personal issues that she raised, I'm raising in a slightly different context, because fortunately I have not had to experience those or pay the price that people like her have had to. And likewise with regards to Monica, her life is testimony to the work and to the empowerment and to the necessity to include women in all processes, especially conflict resolution, peace building, and what follows on. And no peace is sustainable unless that actually takes place. And that is one of the things that an analysis of any kind of historical context of conflict, the causes of conflict, and the maintenance of peace will be based on the inclusion of everybody, but the requirement especially of women, who throughout the world find themselves marginalized, disenfranchised, and impoverished, mostly through the policies that men dictate. And I often think of many of the conflicts in the world, if women had been more, you know, they can only do a better job than the men of the world have done in terms of the context that we find ourselves in. And I begin by saying, when we look at the situation around the world today, I mean, up to about 10 years ago, actually, conflict was being reduced. The levels of international and civil wars was actually getting less. But really, since, I suppose, the Iraq war, the levels of conflict, especially internationalized conflicts in places like Syria, is just one example. So there's a huge involvement by the United Nations in these types of situations. And with regard to, we just take Syria, I mean, someday peace will come to Syria. It will come. It doesn't seem, you know, the prospect of that seems pretty dismal right now. But the United Nations is the multilateral organization that will play a central role. And I would say that it reflects the evolving nature of peacekeeping and some of the real difficulties that I personally would refer, and this is my opinion, is when you read the report that we've referred to, that Niamh has put together on the Congo, for example, there's been the development within the peacekeeping operations there of an intervention brigade, which is essentially a combat unit, which is not actually consistent with the normal precepts that we understand peacekeeping is based on: consent, impartiality, non-use of force. And in my view, I regret to say that when I look at Mali, I look at Central African Republic, I look around the world at the UN interventions, military interventions, actually I think they've been driven largely by the French, the British, and the Americans from their experience in counter-terrorism operations in Afghanistan. And they refer to them as stability operations, but it's a respectable term for actually a form of combat. And I'm a former soldier, but I have great reservations about the nature and direction of current peacekeeping operations at the behest of the United Nations. And I say that from the perspective of someone that is a strong advocate of the relevance and importance and the centrality of the UN in international affairs. At the heart of any type of operation must be the protection of civilians, but within that capacity must come a broad definition of what security means. It's not just personal and state security, but you must have aspects of human security such as access to water, food, healthcare, education, land. You must have the empowerment of all groups, but especially women. And as Muna pointed out with regard to the Syrian situation and elsewhere, we have now, you know, in many of the conflicts that are taking place around the world, what's referred to as the commodification of women and girls as part of the political economy of war. And the United Nations has a huge responsibility to respond to this in an effective way. One other characteristic of the UN interventions of recent times, and this is reflected certainly in the Congo, but it's also elsewhere, is that you have a UN presence ostensibly with the consent of the host state, but actually most national governments no longer want, in some of these critical situations, no longer want a UN presence. Certainly if you ask the Assad regime in Syria, does it want an international presence represented by the United Nations, the answer would be no. But it is the case in the Kabila regime, in the DRC, they would like to see the end of the UN operation. So one of the issues that I refer to that is controversial is the accountability of peacekeepers. Because if you're there representing the United Nations, then UN personnel, both civilian, military and police, must be accountable for all of their actions. And in the last number of years, there's been a lot of controversy about the sexual abuse and exploitation of women and minors. And it's a terrible reflection on a few participants in peacekeeping operations. But it also reflects a broader, what I would say, failure of UN peacekeepers to really buy into a gendered response to the crisis where they find themselves. There have, of course, been responses by the United Nations, but if you look at the Central African Republic and the Congo, the reports of sexual abuse and rape by civilian UN troops has been appalling. Mm. The most recent ones to emerge from the French contingent and some others in the Central African Republic. I won't repeat some of the allegations that have been made, but they have been corroborated. Shamefully, when a UN representative within the Office of the High Commissioner for Human Rights tried to raise this, they tried to shut him down, the whistleblower. Instead of lauding him for highlighting, which was a shameful act by UN peacekeepers, the system closed in on him. It's really important that as part of any UN operation, that there are gender advisors at every level. But in many of the situations where UN peacekeepers find themselves, women and girls are very vulnerable. So you also need women protection advisors. So the whole UN operation has to have effective respect and inculcation of these values. Otherwise, it will not work. So we have Resolution 1325 and many other resolutions relating to women, peace and security, etc., some of them binding, some of them not. But we do need gender mainstreaming across all UN operations in an effective way. And as Monica pointed out, it's about the implementation. At a high level in the Security Council in New York, you can adopt all the resolutions relating to many of the challenges around the world, but there has to be buy-in by those that are on the ground trying to implement them. I refer to one particular failure, which captures to some extent, and I'm being a bit overly critical perhaps, but it's the UN peacekeepers in Haiti. And it reflects where I often say to people, when I'm a lawyer as well, and I often say to people, the last thing you should ever do is follow a lawyer's advice, because they can give you really bad advice. In Haiti, the United Nations operation brought cholera to that small part of the world. 8,000 people at least have died directly as a consequence of that cholera. And many more have been seriously ill. It is the UN, it is a contingent from the UN brought it there. The UN has not acknowledged its responsibility, its moral and ethical responsibility to these people. It has adopted a legalistic approach, which technically as a lawyer I can say I could back up myself. But like the Catholic Church 2 decades ago, when confronted with the abuse that was evident that they were responsible for, they adopted a legalistic approach. It's not always the right thing to do. So due diligence of UN peacekeepers is critical. And you look at situations like Iran and Afghanistan on a much greater level, international, not necessarily UN forces, but often UN-approved forces have been responsible for torture, unlawful killings, and civilian casualties. Now, how does this complex situation arise where accountability is so problematic? Well, one is a status of force agreement. Before any government will agree to contribute UN forces, it will insist that those forces will remain subject to national jurisdiction. So when we send our troops, that's for those of us that are Irish, to the Golan Heights, to South Lebanon, and to the other parts of the world, one of the conditions is that they're subject to Irish national law, not Syrian law, not Lebanese law. So the responsibility falls on the national authorities to take action against where there are violations of national or international law. And this is reflected in the agreements between Ireland and the United Nations and all the other countries that contribute. But the problem is that states' willingness to prosecute is problematic. There are also practical challenges. There are disparities between the states' laws. Some states make certain actions lawful, and others make them unlawful. There's dual criminality, access to witnesses, evidence, admissibility, and a range of other things. But also critical to this is communication with victims. And most of the victims, not all exclusively, but most of the victims of sexual abuse will be women and girls. It also does include boys and, on rare occasions, men. But primarily, it's women and girls. And a failure to address them and to include them in a resolution of this problem is problematic in my view. Now, the UN has brought in many standards and codes of conduct. There's a bulletin on special measures for the protection of from sexual exploitation. And a bulletin in UN terms is like a legal directive. It's something that binds UN personnel in the field. And then there's model standards, memorandums, and various responses have been made. Probably the most important would have been Prince Zayed's report of 2005, which we hoped would lead to a resolution of this particular issue. There's the establishment of a conduct and discipline unit within the UN. There's a greater emphasis on training and national certificates of compliance, not just with issues regarding sexual violence, but also issues regarding gender awareness and human rights awareness. So there are real efforts being made, but my fear is that many of them aren't uniform and don't reflect a comprehensive approach by all participants in UN peacekeeping. There was a victim assistance strategy adopted in 2008, which is laudable, but it still doesn't make the people who have suffered as a consequence of this central to resolving the problem. So one recommendation I would make in terms of any UN operation, and it doesn't contradict the report that Niamh has drafted, which I completely agree with. When you're going into the field and you want to solve a problem and you want to make it sustainable, you begin with from the bottom up, and you begin with civil society and you engage everybody from the bottom up. But when you're dealing with UN operations, I actually suggest that one of the key factors to ensuring, or at least increasing the prospect of success, would be to focus on commanders. Because individuals can have a huge impact, especially military commanders and civilian superiors in the field. The tone that they set is critical to the nature of every mission. I often, when I'm teaching students about conflict resolution, one of the things that you can never convey in a classroom is the subjective factors that individual people can make, mm-hmm. despite a context. Individuals' personalities are critically important. So individual commanders and individual superiors, civilian, whether military, police, and whatever gender, it doesn't matter. They have a critical role to play, and they must buy into this, and they must provide effective training and leadership. And a failure to do this must be reflected in their performance evaluation and in command responsibility, making them responsible for what their subordinates do under a well-known principle of law. So Now, with regard to...
Can I just give you your warning?
Yes, thank you. With regard to sexual abuse and exploitation, one of the really important things to do is to not just see this as a disciplinary and legal issue, but to see it as a human rights abuse that falls somewhere between an ordinary criminal offence and an offence under international law. It's difficult to assess the problem. There are many allegations, and it's difficult to get absolute data which you can rely on. But one of the alternatives to the current system would be to have on-site courts martials, to have trial investigation and monitoring, and to have a UN ombudsperson. Now, some of the conclusions that I would draw, because I'm going kind of quickly to finish on time, is that military intervention, which is often called for in Syria and elsewhere around the world, well, it's a mixed blessing, and it may be the catalyst for further gender-based violence rather than a solution. So we have to be really careful in the strategies and tactics and the nature of the response. There's a lack of transparency often in regards to how challenges such as sexual abuse or other forms of, you know, or failure of policies to be implemented within the United Nations, and there's inconsistent national practice. Accountability remains problematic, and we need to institutionalize procedures and have monitoring and reporting mechanisms for proper follow-up. Victims need to be put central to these issues. It's actually ironic that it's not the easiest group of people to deal with in terms of discipline are the military, because they're subject to a legal framework that civilians and police officers are not. So civilian members are also a major problem in some operations. For example, the Democratic Republic of the Congo's contingent as a whole was essentially dismissed from the peacekeeping force, the UN peacekeeping force in the Central African Republic, and sent packing to go home because of violations, rampant violations by that contingent as a peacekeeping force in the Central African Republic. So what are my recommendations really that link into what we're talking about? Well, you must ensure a gender lens is applied in disarmament, demobilization, reintegration, security sector reform, and justice reform. These are all of the programs and policies that are adopted in trying to confirm a peaceful agreement. You know, when we have peace in Syria, then establishing that and maintaining it and building on it will be critical. All of these will be necessary. We need to ensure the deployment of gender expertise and missions, both advisors and women protection, gender advisors and women protection advisors. Because without them in the field, I mean, in practical terms, it would be ideal if you could have a ratio of 50-50 to men and women in terms of peacekeeping operations, civilian police and military, but that's not likely. So in order to compensate at least for this, and for often among male hierarchical organizations, you need to have people there to remind them that women's experience can be different from men's. And even that's a gross generalization. Within that, you have to take into account culture, social issues, and the complexities of every different experience of individuals and communities. You need to include sexual violence concerns in mediation and peace processes, particularly in the context of security arrangements and transitional justice mechanisms. We're all aware from the media of the vulnerability of women and girls in places like Syria and elsewhere where there are conflict taking place. It's acknowledged as a tactic of war, it's acknowledged as a strategy, but how do we deal with it? How do we stop it? And it is critical that any UN presence, military and otherwise, is aware of this and from the outset has put in place policies to deal with it in an effective way. So I would conclude by saying it's critical that the United Nations accept that the nature of the way that peacekeeping operations are evolving may be dominated to some extent by some of the permanent members of the Security Council who see it as a way of projecting particular power. My great fear is that ultimately, although the most recent UN report identified this and said it should not happen, that the UN may be used in counter-terrorism operations. That is anathema to what UN peacekeeping and the founders of the United Nations had a vision for the future in respect of. It's critical that systemic-based gender discrimination is identified at the outset and that every operation at every level have relevant people who will buy into the need to identify, highlight, and ensure the implementation of a gendered lens approach to the issues on the ground, and that they are sensitive to the vulnerabilities of the people that they're there to protect in the first place, the civilian population. So I look forward maybe to some questions later. Yes. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ray, for that, and thank you for the strong gender lens you brought to the whole issue of peacekeeping and indeed, I'm afraid, deserved criticism of the UN. We have to criticise in order to work to improve. I still, when I worked in the UN and now as a special envoy from time to time, and even if I'm not working for the UN, I always think of Winston Churchill's comment about democracy, that it's the worst system except for all the others. So the UN is the worst system in many ways, but it's the only system and we have to constantly improve it. Monica, I'd like, if I may, to turn to you for an initial reaction to what Ray said, and then I'm going to open to the floor for any questions to both of you, because we don't have very much time. We have just over a quarter of an hour. But first, how do you respond to what Ray was presenting?
Well, I think he's absolutely right that not only do you need the experts, but you need it mainstreamed. And I mean, that was always the issue for me in domestic violence. And when I was training the police right back 25 years ago, was that they would have little specialist units who could deal with it, because the others preferred to deal with dog licenses than enforce non-molestation orders. And they'd tell you that. And so the issue was, no, we need to train all right across, but the leadership is so important.
Yeah.
And if you have the champion coming from the top, sometimes that's a woman who's taken over the role because she's got a specific interest and she may indeed have some experience of it. But particularly mostly in the field that Ray's talking about, it is men. And I have seen the Norwegians doing this. And I've been at talks where they've talked it down through and explained how they did it. And what they said is something similar to what I've said to our police in this last paramilitary report. It's actually the small things in the community that you'll get the most information from. And that's the smart piece of intelligence gathering. You don't wait for some dissident to plant a bomb and expect somebody to inform on who it was. But if you've built up enough confidence amongst your community policing, amongst your community soldiering, then they will come forward if they believe and have watched you and understood you to be a trusted person of integrity. And they will then come with bigger information at a later stage, which may be of importance to you in your military operation. And that's why it's so important, not only for this work to go on inside the actual military regime, but also to extend out into the community in your everyday practice.
Thank you very much, Monica. I must say, I was kind of struck by another way in which there's an attempt to bring the highest authority in a country to bear on women's empowerment, girls and women, etc. And that is the He for She campaign, which you and women are now running,
and
which
President Higgins has signed
Secretary General as the first He for She, and then heads of state all over the world and other figures of authority, precisely to make it, you know, a kind of so that the mission comes from the top about the importance of it. So I think that's a valuable point. Now, I see hands all over the place, yes. One, two, three, four. And then we'll get others, yeah. So over on this side and then at the back. Yeah, the hand that's showing there, and then about towards the end of that side, and then here in front, and yeah.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Can you give your name? I know spoke earlier.
Shelley Dean, Brehon Advisory. Thank you very much for your presentations. I'm struck by the notion that peacekeepers must not be used for counterterrorism, but I'm also struck by the fact that Monica mentioned the violence of voice, and we do a lot of work in the Middle East, and mindful that counterterrorism is not countering radical extremism, is there space and room for a knowledge and empathy-based approach to peacekeeping, peace-building, using women as the champions? And if so, what would that look like? So if we have adopting Northern Ireland's knowledge and empathy-based approach to policing, which ultimately changed the dynamic in the 1990s, is there a way we can navigate that into working with women in relation to peace building and countering violent extremism?
I'm sure Monica's dying to jump into that, but I'm not going to let her. Well, let's get four questions and then our comments.
Okay.
Yes.
Sorry, can you hear me?
Yeah.
No, sorry, it's Kate Donnelly. I'm a community worker here in County Mayo. And this is very much for Monica. It's not so much a question,
yeah,
it's more of a comment. That having lived, I was living in Belfast in a strongly nationalist area at the time of the Good Friday Agreement and the elections around that time. And I think that when the Women's Coalition came along, it was very much a case of, because there was nothing more important than the national question at that time in Republican areas. And it was very much, there was a kind of a mild campaign to try and paint you as the other. That, you know, the Women's Coalition, who are they? It's very challenging. Maybe they're unionists, so don't vote for them. But I'm so happy to say that so many women in nationalist areas and unionist areas actually did vote for you. And a lot of them voted for you secretly, because to admit that they voted for you was to be seen as a traitor to the cause, almost. And I think that it's really, really important that you're not written out of history around the Good Friday Agreement, because having spoke to people who were involved in the negotiations would very, very clearly say that it was your presence at that table that added something, a different, that other space, and Mo Molum as well, that actually contributed. And I'm not sure that we'd have the Good Friday Agreement had you not been there, being honest with you. So I think it's really, really important that you're not written out of history, and so that, and for all to be mindful of that. And I think one of the most exciting things that came out of the Good Friday Agreement for me was the Bill of Rights, but it's gone. I haven't heard it. It's not really, it's on nobody's agenda, not really. So it heartens me today to hear that it's coming back on the agenda and not before time. So I think that is the way forward. And I personally like to thank Monica and the Women's Coalition for all the contribution to that.
Thank you very much for that. I have to say, I know all about secret voting. You can't get elected as president of this country without a lot of people going out. I heard a very good comment about that. It's just such a funny story in a way. I was giving a talk in Boise, Idaho about 10 years ago now. And at the end of the talk, and it was quite a crowd that came out, about 300 or 400, because the Irish came out, you know, because I was a former president, and I was talking about economic and social rights and the work of realizing rights, and a lot of focus on Africa, but also on the United States. And then this woman came up to the, and I could see, you know, she had her hand out, obviously to shake hands with me, so I came down from the podium, and she said, "I want to shake your hand," she said. "You are my first vote. I was 19 at the time, and when I told my father, he nearly killed me." And I'm sure you had that experience, Monica. Yeah. Anyway, now, yes, in the front here, and then, yeah.
Thank you very much. My name is Connie Conway, Mission Carra. Two very quick
questions. More microphone, please.
Sorry.
That's it now.
Yeah. Okay, Connie Conway, Mission Carra. Two very quick questions. First one is on the issue of Syria becoming a majority state of women. If I recall correctly, Rwanda faced a similar situation.
Sorry, Rwanda faced the issue of Syria becoming a majority state of women. Rwanda faced a similar situation after the genocide in 1994. And perhaps Mary or Monica, just wondering whether there's any of the options, solutions, which they were able to use that might be also of relevance for the Syrian situation. Second question to Ray on your excellent presentation. To what extent what you're recommending is that already been implemented in the various peacekeeping training centres, for example, the one that the Irish Army is running in the Curra?
Okay, thank you. And I'll take one more question and then we'll have time for another round.
Thank you. My name's Anne Singleton. I'm from the University of Bristol and I work with the International Organisation for Migration in the Global Migration Data Analysis Centre in Berlin. And I was very moved by this session. Thank you for all the very brilliant insights into how we might, the lessons that you're teaching us about how we might pursue improving the situation for migrants now. And for the first time in the SDGs, we have migration as a goal under target 10.7. States are being required to facilitate safe and orderly and safe migration. And we're seeing very clearly now that it's not happening in the European Union and in the UK. It's now a very dangerous, it's always been unsafe, it's becoming very vulnerable and dangerous for all sorts of reasons that we all know. And I wondered if this was a hook that we could link together, that target 10.7 comes under inequality, if we can link together with all the other targets that include migration and migration-related aspects, to say if we don't look after the human rights of migrants, then in the most vulnerable people in society and who are the 60 million displaced people across the world, then there'll be nobody left to look after us. If it's the same story. And I've seen that happen. It's accelerating now, that the rights of migrants are not being addressed. So I was very heartened to see how we could use steps to take actions and have targets and have benchmarks. And I'd very much like to take your examples from the reports you spoke about and use those when we speak to policymakers and governments about how to implement the SDGs. So thank you.
Thank you very much for that very important point. I'm going to invite Monica first, maybe, and then Ray.
The first question is around this countering violent extremism. I have a little concern, and I don't know if Mary shares this or Ray. I attended one of the sessions, the last session of the, it was the largest session ever of the United Nations Security Council on evaluating UN 1325, 15 years on, and Spain added on an extra resolution, which was including women. It probably wasn't as dictatorial as making sure women are in the counter-violent extremism debate. And I thought, oh no, this is not a good way to approach the inclusion of women. Because where I come from, you have to handle this issue really carefully. And I've just dealt with it in the disbandment of paramilitary reports, is how to give information in society where you were seen previously to be an informer or a tout, as we would have called it, and that would have really labelled you and been very dangerous, to moving to a society of a culture for the respect of law, where it is seen where there is a criminal or illegal activity that it would be purposeful and understandable that you would give early information and be an early preventative mechanism. And we've always talked about women being early preventative mechanisms. In the Pray the Devil Back to Hell film on Liberia,
yeah,
that's exactly what they called themselves. And they went across then to other African countries outside of Liberia to show how women can be early preventative mechanisms. And that's the approach I would take to CVE, to the countering violent extremism, is that women have knowledge that maybe nobody else has. They know what's going on in the streets and the villages and the communities because they have to keep their children safe, to keep themselves safe, and because they are doing the everyday unpaid and mostly community work. And that's the bit that I was saying is really important. And I'm concerned now that they're losing a lot of those resources. We certainly are facing a lot of closures. And that won't help in getting more information coming forward. The commander that I visited in the prison of one of the paramilitaries that's not on ceasefire, we have a politically separated regime in our prisons. I've been visiting them for years, first as the Human Rights Commissioner and more recently as the Oversight Commissioner for Prison Reform. And then I had to go back this past 6 months and sit down with them and talk to them about the possibility of where they're going next. This is the group not on ceasefire. He's 23 years of age and has been radicalised, mostly, I would say, inside prison. When I first met him, he was arrested at 17 or 18, and now he's a great big brigadier and commander and sees himself in that role. So a lot of masculinity attached to this. When I visited the loyalist prisoners on the other side, they were going back to doing what they had done. Prison hadn't changed them one bit. So my question is, what can we do when we've got a captive audience like that inside prisons that we can begin to challenge a lot of what has gone on outside? Because he really does see himself, and as did many of the big brigadiers and commanders that I talked to. They said to me, Monica, are you serious? You want me to give up my role as a brigadier and a commander and become a wump? A wump? I said, there's a hell of a distance between a brigadier and a commander and a wump. You know, they're the two extremes of either side. I said, you're still much needed in a different role in your community. Why do you still hold on to this status? So I do think women definitely bring a gender perspective to that. There's an awful lot of masculinity tied up in being that role. And you talk to those young men, what are they telling you about? It's an identity. It's respect. It's self-esteem that they don't have in any other way in their life. And I have to say that really worries me. And so in my report on the disbandment of paramilitaries, I wrote a whole section on that in terms of the marginalisation and what we can do around. Some of it's to do with bullying and intimidation, and they're bullied and intimidated into these roles. And some of it is that that's the only identity in an otherwise completely deprived and disadvantaged community. And they get some kickback from being seen as, they called it, the go-to man. And so I learned a lot in this process that it wasn't unusual for people who are working in Honduras or Guatemala or El Salvador in terms of the work with gangs. So I put some of that into my report. Needless to say, I met the brigadiers and commanders last Monday, and they said, well, we knew there was a woman wrote that report when we started reading about masculinity.
Do you want to answer the point about Rwanda, Syria?
I was going to give that one to you, Mary.
Well, you have a go first.
Yeah, I'm hoping I've got that right. Was what can Syria learn from the process of Rwanda?
That Rwanda had such a sort of majority of women because of the genocide and had to change.
Yeah. I would be one of those who would be worried about Rwanda.
Yeah.
I don't think we should hold Rwanda up as the best performance model.
Yeah.
I have serious concerns about what's going on in Rwanda. And it's certainly not the direction of travel that you would have expected. And it is good to see that there are a number of women that have been elected to their parliament. And they quote it all over the world as 50%. But it's only 47 women in a very large country. But apart from that, I also do believe, and you must always ask this question, what are the principles those women are working to? What is their value system? What is it that is driving them to peace building? And that was the question for us in the coalition. Put it as Mary has said all her life, walk the foundation based on human rights. And it's not just my rights, it's your rights. And that's my concern about Rwanda. I do know for people like Mona, and Mary and I, my sister, she's my blood sister. Sometimes us feminists talk about her sister, my birth sister. My minder, she says. She comes with me to all of these things because it's a lonely old journey, as many of you know, at times when you go around on your own. And Mary and I both know Mona. And we've both been to the Geneva Peace Talks because, again, we were asked to go back and do a capacity-building workshop as they were entering the peace talks. And, those women were so struggling in their hearts about how they were going to sit next to the women from the Assad regime, given everything that had been done to them. And I must pay credit to Stefan de Mistura, Mary. That was a very innovative process that he established. I don't know if Mona was, if you understood what she was saying. This is a very new, innovative UN approach to peace talks, where Stefan de Mistura has, by proxy, got the high National Commission of the Opposition, which we have worked with. And on that, there are women. And then Assad has come, well, he didn't come, but he's got his negotiators, and on his team, there are women. There are three women. In fact, Assad brought five, and that suddenly made the other lot push theirs up to five, which is great. But de Mistura then said, but I need outside of these two, and they probably are predominantly the ones who fought the war. I need civic society groups. And so he established a parallel consultative committee from civic society, many of whom are women, women we know. And then he also established, where Mona is sitting, a women's advisory group, consultative group, to consult him so that he can go back all the time, check out with them, they can go back and check out with their communities. But that women's advisory group is made up of women from Assad's regime and from the opposition. Hmm. And they are being asked to sit next to each other and to work across their differences. Hmm. When there is no ceasefire, when Aleppo is being bombed with chemicals, when they are ringing their families, as we saw in front of us, ringing home to find out what kind of torture was just done on their sister last week. Can you imagine having to do that? I had to do it, but we had moved on by the time the peace talks came. I mean, as I tell people, a very good friend, a boyfriend, not a dating boyfriend, but a good boyfriend of mine was murdered in 1974 in the Ulster Worker Council strike, and I had to sit right next to the party that I knew had been responsible for his murder and torture, and torture. Before they killed him, they tortured him. And that's what you do. That's what, as Mandela told us when he brought us to South Africa, you're not going to sit beside people that you get on with. You're going to sit beside people that you don't get on with, because that's why the war was created. And that's where Mona is coming from. And what a struggle those women are going through at the moment. So all the support that we can possibly give them. And that's, I think Syria will find its own way. It won't look at Rwanda. As what's happening in Syria is very, very different. And at the moment, fair play to them. Mona's talking about building a constitution. Building a constitution when the most massive violations of human rights are occurring all around them. But it just shows you the little bit of light that they're holding out for their future, and they have to.
Yeah, I must say that was going to be my response as well. More, no one size fits all. Rwanda was its own case, and I would agree that there are issues of human rights there that are quite concerning. Ray, a chance to respond, and then I'm going to take one last round. If people really want to ask a question, you have an opportunity. I'll take about two more that we'll have time for.
Okay, so I'll attempt to, because even now I'm a little bit confused as to the questions when you get a number of them. But I would like to, the woman here in the front who said, you know, after Resolution 1325 and we are implementing the gender mainstream within UN peace operations. But the point I try to make is actually we may be doing so on paper, but in reality it's not happening. If you look at the discussions in the Security Council, look at the Russians, the Chinese, the Pakistanis and the Egyptians right now, and you'll see overt resistance to recognising the importance of these issues, downright hostility in some cases. But the way the response of the United Nations operation in the Central African Republic to the more recent scandals regarding the French and some others reflected a complete failure of the system to respond and to react appropriately, not just to prevent, but it actually, eventually the Secretary General's Special Representative there was forced to resign as a consequence of the inadequate response. So I'm saying that actually, no, we haven't done anything near enough. Yes, I would say I would praise the Irish Defence Forces for making it central to their training and to really making it not just for UN peacekeepers, but to the culture of the Defence Forces. But that's just, we were only a very small example. With regard to women and the role of women, one of the things that makes me sad is for a number of years I travelled to Libya with an Italian NGO called No Peace Without Justice, and we worked with civil society and we worked with the government officials, but we also worked with women's groups. And I often wonder what has happened to them because of the security situation that now prevails in Libya makes it unsafe for work of this nature. But I remember being greatly impressed and, in fact, offering to bow out of the engagement with the women because I felt as a man from a foreign culture, it wouldn't be maybe appropriate or it might not be helpful. But in most instances, they asked me to remain. And I met and encountered some of the strongest, most impressive people that had endured some really horrific stories personally and to their families. But they had no history of proper governance under the Gaddafi regime, nor had they any tradition of civic engagement or civil society as we understand it. But the resource and the enthusiasm and ability to begin to respond, except that the central ground was seized by extremists and, you know, the violent elements dominated by men on both sides meant that those groups were pushed and marginalised out from the really good progress that was being made from the ground up. So, I mean, how do you counter violent extremism? Well, I'm sorry if this sounds really touchy-feely and pretty useless. One of the ways that I really keep reminding myself, because I remember watching the migrants fleeing Syria, and I remember them facing tear gas and batons and the fences and barriers of Europe. And what we have to make is human rights principles fundamental to how we deal with every aspect of human activity, but especially crisis. And we as individuals have a responsibility. Like, I don't mind admitting that I was a little bit disillusioned by the EU's response to the financial crisis in Ireland and Greece. But I vehemently hoped that I would have, if I had been in the United Kingdom, I would have been advocating for the original values of the European Union, what it stood for, why it was founded in the first place. And those values are really important, and they are what are most under threat now. And so it's really important that we always, especially when we're confronted by violent situations like Brussels or recently what happened in Istanbul, that remember the purpose of all that is actually that we will look on our neighbour differently and that we will treat them differently. So if we can learn to respect human rights in the broadest sense and live together, then I think that that is the best way of countering violent extremism. I know it's touchy-feely. I know it's not a specific policy that you apply, but I really believe it's the most important way of ensuring that we remain respectful and that we demonstrate the ability to be multicultural, to respect different beliefs, different traditions, and to live together, because there's no hope for us otherwise.
And I think, just so we don't forget your question on migration, I think we should take a moment to pay tribute to all of those in this room who are working on that issue. Mm. It is the issue of our time, along with climate change and these huge outcomes of wars. Yeah. And it's the oldest problem. It's our current problem. How to live well together. Together. And I am certain that the Brexit vote was based on migration. Mm. I have no doubt about that. Mm. And how 500 million Europeans could not accommodate what was coming from Afghanistan and Syria in total crisis, given their memories of where we had built Europe all those years ago. I'm just very saddened. I think we're living in hard times. And it's up to people in this room and all of us to stand up to this kind of thinking. So all I can say is I pay tribute to you. Mm-hmm. I'm not sure I can give you much more advice, because it's your area of expertise, but I certainly know that that this issue is going to be the issue of the next decade. Mm. There's no doubt about that.
Thank you very much, Monica. Actually, I think we are out of time, and I think you're probably fairly exhausted anyway. It's been a very intensive and very rich discussion, and actually, I think since I'm going to be giving concluding remarks, and they will, I promise you, be brief, I'm going to stand to make them.
I just really wanted to say that in real terms, this symposium was so much better than my highest expectations. Now, what more can I say? You know, so much better. So, and I think we have a lot to think about. And let me begin maybe with the point that Monica was taking up, the very good question about the people on the move whose human rights are being totally disregarded, whether they are refugees or migrants, both of whom have human rights, and who are dying in their thousands now, trying to cross the Mediterranean. And, you know, it is shocking that we don't have enough voices speaking out on that, that we haven't got that those values being thundered from the heights about it.
Absolutely.
I mean, we're all being diminished by the fact that this is happening, and somehow it's happening in our name, whether we like it or not, if we don't speak out. So I think that's something that is very crucial. We began with a broader discussion about the Sustainable Development Goals, and we acknowledge that this symposium is very well timed because there will be the high-level political forum in New York in July. And I hope that some of the values that we've been talking about here will inform that process somehow, that we can get those values across.
And then we had a discussion of the three Sustainable Development Goals, which were identified as being very cross-cutting and, I believe, as we heard the discussions, very linked, very linked. We had, first of all, earlier this morning, the discussion on mobilizing resources to achieve gender equality and empower all women and girls. And we saw how important it is that we break out of the mold of the current, where women are largely seen as victims or grassroots, and it's microcredit, and not as being central to resourcing at all levels, etc. And that we do acknowledge the importance and wisdom of grassroots women and get them more into decision-making roles, but that we understand that mobilizing resources is going to be key. And that, I think, is because we need empowered women. We need women who have the capacity to be in the leadership that is needed, which leads into the combating inequalities within and between countries. How central it is within countries and between countries that we counter inequality by ensuring that women's voices, women's presence, women's agency, and that we find ways to measure effectively that. And then in this rich session on promoting just, peaceful and inclusive societies, that we understand the importance of the inclusive as being very significantly inclusive of those who have the knowledge and the experience and the wisdom, but are often invisible. Sense that these are the very voices, that there are so many barriers to them being heard and being included. And I think there was a wisdom in having the symposium focus on these three, but we need to think about just how the discussion has treaded a strong linkage, and the linkage really comes back to the importance of having balanced societies rooted in human rights that can address the issues of equality, the issues of the grosser, wider inequality within and between countries, and the importance of the just societies that are promoting peaceful and inclusive societies. As I listened, particularly to Monica, I kind of almost had a nostalgia for my mandate for the Great Lakes region. And, I think... Nolene, you made an interesting point this morning, and people laughed because you said that when you became a USG and head of the Economic Commission for Asia, that you felt your power.
Yes.
And I had something the same sense when I was given this mandate, because I was told I was the first woman to be a senior mediator of that kind. It's another of these barriers that you try to help to break down, that I would be the special envoy for the Great Lakes region. But I realized there's such a difference between knowing what you want to achieve and actually achieving it. It was a real struggle, and not a successful struggle. Mm-hmm. But I have so many memories of how important it was to meet with women in Goma, to meet with women everywhere I went, to meet with civil society, at times to meet with the women separate from the men, to listen to their complaints, and then to find a way with a women's platform to try to bring that together. We had 13 countries in the end. We had four organizations, and the UN itself, the African Union, the International Conference, the Great Lakes Region, and SADC, and almost all of the representatives were men. The only way that I could sort of find a device to try and break down this a bit was to have a good friend of mine, and I'm sure of a number of us in this room, Binta Diop, because she was appointed by Madam Zuma as chair of the Commission of the African Union as her special representative on women, peace and security. Mm. And so I could ask her, in the context of her mandate, to be in the discussions. it was kind of, and then try to widen that. And that's why I very much agree with you that what's happening with Mistura, the fact that he's really trying to involve women in a very intelligent way, and then to use the capacity of women, which we saw in Northern Ireland,
It was women from both sides in Northern Ireland who helped that peace process mm-hmm. so enormously, and I so admired that. So he's doing that in Syria. He's managing to find a context where women will sit together where men wouldn't. And I think the more we can learn even from that example and from the potentials of that. Okay, now my last and very pleasant duty is to say a few thank yous around the place. I made a mess of this when I was speaking the other evening in opening because my papers were all messed up because I couldn't download what was being sent to me. But so I was using different bits. But I have it all here now very smoothly in front of me. And I just want to recall the contributions that were made, starting with the opening session, very ably moderated by Paul Gillespie, who I'm glad to see has stayed with us and I hope has benefited from staying on and not disappearing into the night. We heard a very passionate presentation from Nolene Hazer, and I think it gave a good sense that we were going to hear a lot of personal passion, as we've had in this conference. And we also recognized that gender and gender equality and the themes of this symposium are also very much the province of men who understand and who support so strongly the gender and human rights agenda, as Colm O'Gorman so ably did on that panel. And then this morning, I had the great pleasure of moderating three women, as it happened, but they were, I think, very complementary to each other in their presentations. We first of all heard from Geraldine Fraser Mulliketty, and I think she brought a huge knowledge of what it will take to get the multilateral development agencies, notably the banks. She was talking about the African Development Bank, and then Nolene was able to complement that with the Asia Development Bank, how we really get gender actively prioritized. And I think that that's what is happening now in the African Development Bank, and I will be your agent on this high-level panel that I'm on, Geraldine, to really promote and carry on your work. I was very glad that we were able to have Heather Grady here, because you could tell from what she was saying, and she's quite modest about it, that she has actually brought philanthropy to a different stage with this platform on philanthropy, with a number of other partners, but she's the key person in it, as I know. And she's, by doing this, getting philanthropy to understand what are the areas that really need addressing. And I thought it was really good to see that there has been too much of a focus on health, and that actually we need to use the broader funding platform that is used by the funds that understand women's issues and that are close to grassroots women, and they use that broader. I thought that was very insightful. And I'm not skipping over Nolene, who came back and had, a very rich sharing of her experience. I can't speak for how they performed the next panel, because I obviously wasn't there, but I know them, and I know that Peter will have been able to bring particularly the situation of children fully into the mix. And Diane Elson clearly knows so many of the people in the room that she could empathize, I think, with all of the issues that were talked about. And Sorley McCaughey, again, I know very well for his work in Christian Aid. And we then come to this panel, and we were very moved, I think, by Mona Ghanem speaking so both personally and from the heart and so well on that video, and then to have Monica respond by saying she could see her sadness, see her grief, see her grief visibly for a very strong, very significant woman in relation to Syria and its future peace. And then Monica herself, I think, has drawn on an incredible experience in her presentation. And she too has been first in a lot of ways in Northern Ireland, in a way that has been very important for
for Northern Ireland itself, and she's brought that then to a much wider range of women. And I think that Northern Ireland is a very good place to draw on for empowering lessons for women, because it was tough, as you know, and even continues to be relatively a tough world. And so I think it can be very encouraging, and you're doing that in such an extraordinary way. And Ray, again, it was good to hear a male voice have such a strong gender lens and such a strong critique of things that were not adequately dealt with, in particular the accountability of the UN, especially for what peacekeepers do, because that undermines the whole ethos of the United Nations. And I have to say, you know, the United Nations has tried with its rights up front, you know, its human rights first approach, and has, you know, tried to make that more of a broader policy. But nonetheless, I think your criticisms were very valid and have to be taken taken on board. I just now want to really thank those who were wise enough to know how to structure these panels and invite the panelists and make it all happen. I was glad that Niamh Riley has already been properly acknowledged as co-director of the Centre for Global Women's Studies, with her fellow co-director, Nathan. Is she here? Nathan. Yes, she is down there at the back. Stand up, because you haven't been properly acknowledged. And now I would ask Natasha, where's Natasha? I saw her a minute ago. I think, yes, Natasha. Natasha Price to stand up as well, and Amy Lajoie, and Gillian Brown, and Megan Riley. You are the hero and champions. Yes. And indeed, Susan Heffernan of the Mary Robinson Center, as the product coordinator of the center. I think this was a very rich, thoughtful, at times quite emotional symposium, emotional for the right reasons. And I think we all have a lot to think about, a lot to take away. I'm so proud, as I said, that it has happened in my own hometown of Ballina. So, thank you. Thank you also to the audience. Many of you had obviously come quite far, and you were much more diverse than I had thought in all senses. And it was really good to hear the very thoughtful questions. And I would say that is the quality of this symposium, that in a way the questions from the floor matched the quality of the panels that we heard. And you can't ask for more than that. So thank you. Safe journeys to those of you who have to travel further. And stay on in Ballina for those of you who come and enjoy the town. You know, there's lots of life in Ballina, especially on a Saturday. So stay over and enjoy. Okay, thank you.